A bit more embarrassed on the dark side of valuation. Okay? Difficult to value. And if you are able to value this kind of negative earnings company, your payoff as an analyst will be bigger. By the way, why is it difficult? For example, some of these common multiples in valuation does not work. P/E ratio, for example. You need positive earnings per share in the first place. But what if net income is minus? A P/E ratio does not work. Okay? You have one less choice. So, negative earnings, right? It's a difficult one, but there are some things you have to consider if you have this kind of problem. Why does that company have negative earnings? You have to think about it. Maybe five different reasons would be there. One, maybe the company had some really temporary bad outcome. Maybe the company lost some kind of lawsuit, which is really rare to do, infrequent, temporary problems. Or maybe the company is facing a bad industry cycle. Okay? Bad industry cycle. What do you mean? Let's get back to our good old friend Hynix, SK Hynix. DRAM industry. You saw that their, you know, net income or cash flow fluctuates a lot, sometimes down to the deep negative side, sometimes hugely positive. Of course, luckily this year, they say the DRAM industry will be hugely positive swing. So their profit will be huge. But previous years, they were at bottom over here. And I would not be surprised next year or the year after, if they suffer huge loss, no surprise. Okay? It's kind of regular thing, cyclicality going on. Then the question becomes, well, if you're Hynix and then if the Hynix net income was hugely negative right now, what should you do? Okay? Going into the future, in your cash flow projection, okay, earnings projection, what should you assume? Well, earnings growth rate kind of thing. Some of you may say, well, let's think about sine, cosine function and the wavelet kind of function going on here. Don't do the wave here. The wave is useful only in your club. Not in your valuation. Now, rather what they say is that what is recommended is normalizing. It's the average, moving average growth rate. All across different industry cycles, right? Forget about up and down, the average. That's it. Okay, stable growth. That's it. Okay? The third case that you can think about, okay, is that maybe your company is in the younger stage. Okay? Young companies need a lot of reinvestment. As I said before, in your teenage days when you are growing very fast, you eat so much. Reinvest a lot, okay? That's the thing. What do you mean by that? Well, eat a lot and reinvest a lot. What does it have to do with our negative income? That means you may be spending a lot on your R&D. 공부 많이 해. 밤새도록. You study like the crazy. That's a cost to your family. You see how much money your mom and daddy spent for you? Huh? That's the investment, R&D investment, okay? In your younger stage, even right now, you're in the younger stage of investing for your, you know, R&D, right? The same thing, your cost, huge amount of cost R&D, okay? You did not capitalize it, in your accounting statement is net loss. Your parents don't say about it too much, but in their deep down in their heart, mind I wish this, you know, that my kids graduate soon, okay? Get a job somehow. Anyway, the life cycle issue over there is present. That could be one reason. Still another reason is financial distress. Okay, financial distress, what do you mean? In your product market, your customers may welcome your product, like your product, but your balance sheet tells you terrible thing. Maybe your bankers are pissed off. So much debt on your balance sheet, you have to pay so much interest expense. That's different from your R&D expense, right? And that burden, okay, creates a problem. That could be one reason. Lastly, maybe your products are not welcomed in the market in the first place. Regardless of whether you have huge debt or low debt, doesn't matter. You're in economic distress. Maybe your cost structure is too much. Maybe the management is inefficient. Maybe your employees are not working hard enough. Or maybe you're out of fashion. Okay, all kinds of things, right? So economic distress, financial distress, and then life cycle issue could be happening over there. What is driving this negative earnings? You have to think about, you know, what is the reason, okay, when you have negative earnings. Now, depending on this reason, the solution will be different. If the problem is structural, right? If your company is young stage, well, think about, you know, Tesla, for example. Okay, you will see some examples in a couple of slides later. Negative earnings right now, okay, that's okay. In 10 years down the road, our operating margin will converge to industry average. Okay, you need to build up a kind of scenario here. It's a difficult part, okay? You need to make a reasonable scenario for each different case. Typically, you have to set up your margin as close to industry average. In this case especially, and in this case again. We'll come back here. But before that, here, leverage problem. If you have too much debt in your balance sheet, what do you have to assume? Going into the future, we are going to reduce the debt. That's some scenario you have to build up. Okay? Your debt-to-equity ratio or target debt-to-equity ratio, that will be close to industry average, again, right? Thirdly, if your problem is about operating or economic distress, it's kind of similar to part A in that you have to assume a certain target margin, okay, target margin in the long run, where your company will converge later on. For these two cases, okay, financial distress and economic distress, to do this kind of scenario building, okay, you better be like Warren Buffett kind of investor or Carl Icahn kind of investors or in Korea IMM kind of private equity guys. What do you mean? If you have the means to do it or tools to do it. If you can kick out the CEO, right? Currently, the CEO did a bad job in operation or in financial management, so we are not happy, but let's kick him out. And instead, let's put my friends or our experts over there. And then let him reduce the debt or improve the operating margin. Okay? If you can do that, you can do the DCF valuation using this scenario approach. That's the message. Estimating growth when operating income is negative or margin is changing. All of the fundamentals equations assume that the firm has return on equity or return on capital it can sustain in the long run. When operating income is negative or margins are expected to change over time, we use a three-step approach. First, estimate growth rate and revenues over time. Second, estimate the expected operating margin each year. Third, estimate capital needs and capital expenditures to be invested to generate revenue, growth, and expected margins. Now, the first one, you need to, in your building your scenarios, right, you need to have a good revenues estimation. It's more like a top-down approach. First, find out, you know, how much the industry would be like, how much the market size would be like, and then what's going to be your market share, and then accordingly how much of a profit that you can generate by and by. Okay, move on like that. Now, the textbook author gives an example related to Tesla Motors. This is a young company, as you know, and who doesn't know about Tesla these days, right? When I started teaching in Singapore, Tesla was only doing the IPO, right? So it was kind of a hard thing to study. Not many people knew it. Some people who knew it, they were really dedicated into it. Valuation of this was very challenging, because it's in a young stage, right? And then as I said before, younger companies, intensive R&Ds, not much revenues, which means huge net loss. Okay? Huge operating loss as well. That was very difficult to value. Now, those things are getting better, but still, their net income is negative last year. And then how would we value it, okay, in this kind of young company? In this case, the textbook author set up an operating margin. 10 years down the road, it said it's going to converge to industry average operating margin of 12%. And that industry is specified as premium car manufacturers, right? And then the growth of or improvement of operating margin, let's assume it to be linear. Is it correct to assume linear? Don't we have to assume some kind of exponential growth, kind of smooth way of this way or smooth way of that way? Totally depends on you, okay? Totally depends on your story. Only experience tells you. There is no right, absolute right way or wrong way of doing it, okay? Jampa matters, right? So that's partially why you have to go to the industry as soon as possible, okay? Number two, revenue projection demonstrated it, okay? Initial 5 years, the textbook author assumes that it's going to grow at 65% every year. So it's like exponential growth, but at the end of year five, let's be realistic, it's not going to grow at 65% rate forever. Rather, the growth the revenue growth will taper off over time. Okay, taper off so that it will look like S curve or life cycle curve. Okay. Now, this is a picture that I drew based on this table provided by the author. Okay. Year number is shown, base year all the way up to year number 10, revenues, selling revenues last year, and then the growth rate is expected to be 65%. And then, after year number 5, the growth rate itself is declining in linear fashion, actually. Okay? If you do the math, then you will realize it is linearly straight line declining. In terms of rate, the actual revenue itself is S-curve. Operating income, negative, okay? Operating margin is negative, but he said, let's set the operating margin at the end of year 10, the same as high-end auto companies' operating margin. In the meantime, it's going to grow at 10% in a linear fashion. So that's how we handle some negative income companies. Especially if your company is the youngest one. Experience matters. Now, the next thing to think about is the tax rate. Tax rate that you should use in computing the after-tax operating income. Okay, here's a question. This after-tax, the tax rate that you should consider, it should be 1. The effective tax rate in the financial statement. 2. Tax rate based upon taxes paid and EBIT. 3. The marginal tax rate for the country in which the company is incorporated or headquartered. 4, the weighted average marginal tax rate across the countries in which the companies operate. 5, none of the above. 6, all of the above. Answer is? One, please raise your hand. 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, something right. 3 is the answer, okay? Your headquarter country, your incorporated country. Why not? Okay? Why not all the different countries if we have subsidiaries in different places? Indonesia, Malaysia, South Africa, the United States. Why not? Because there's tax treaty most of the time in your country, in our country as well. Different countries have tax treaties to avoid double taxation. And essentially, the amount of tax they pay tends to converge to the marginal tax rate in your headquartered country. And then the tax rate, which one to use, not effective one, but a marginal tax rate. It's more self-explanatory over here, so you can read it later on. But the important problem is over here, a tax rate for money losing firm. When your company lose money, okay, when your company make a loss before tax, right? Then the government gets to the company and say, oh, poor you, don't pay tax this year. And also, there will be some tax credit for you. Tax loss carry forward for the next 3 years, next year, depending on the tax law. So here is a 3-year tax credit goes on, okay? And then, so you're trying to estimate the after-tax operating income for a firm with $1 billion in net operating loss carry forward. The firm is expected to have operating income of $800 million every year, right? And marginal tax rate 40%. Now estimate the after-tax operating income each year for the next 3 years. So, tell me, based on 800, okay, and then you have tax credit of 1 billion, how much tax do you have to pay in your first year? Loss carry forward is there, right? So tax credit used up, and then you pay tax zero, right? So you paid, you used up tax credit of 800, 200 is left. Now, after tax EBIT, how much would it be? 800, and then effective tax rate, how much would it be? This is tax divided by EBIT, okay? It has to be 0%, thank you. Now, second year, you have 800 of EBIT. How much tax do you have to pay over here? You need to first figure out what is the taxable income after knocking off this tax credit. So taxable EBIT would be what? Difference between the two? 600. And you remember marginal tax rate of 40%, so you multiply these two and get what? 240. It's 240. Over here. So subtracting this guy out from your EBIT, your after-tax EBIT would be what? 560. What's your effective tax rate? This guy divided by that. Yes. 30%? Right? In your third year, what happens? Do you have any tax credit left? And the answer is? No. So you are taxed 100%. 800 times 40%, 320. After tax, that would be 480. Effective tax rate would be 40%, the same as marginal tax rate. Make sense? So the effective tax rate over time tends to converge to your marginal tax rate anyway. So why not use marginal tax rate to be safe? the idea. And how volatile is this effective tax rate? And how problematic is it? I'll show you over here. We are using the data about three of big companies in Korea: Samsung Electronics, SK Hynix, Hyundai Motors Company. What's the effective tax rate over here? Holy cow. Minus 3,500%. Wow. How could tax rate be negative? What do you mean? What must have happened over here? What must have happened? Does this mean that the government gave a lot of money back to Samsung Electronics? Here you are, my little Samsung. We love you so much for that tax. We don't need to pay. We pay you. Is it? No. What happened is, profit before tax must have been negative. They must have lost money. Okay. Think about 1996 or 7. It was a terrible year, maybe. Okay. Bad cycle for the industry, for semiconductor. Loss before tax. Still you pay tax. Why do you still pay tax? You know, accounting, right? The tax law is different from accounting law, right? Accounting regulation. Based on GAAP, there must have been profit before tax, which is minus amount. Tax, you still had to pay whatever. That was what's going on, right? B? What was it, B? Okay, so be it. So be it. What is more? That means so be it, right? So B. Now, if you had to pay tax, you know, in tax, balance sheet, you have deferred tax liability sometimes. Okay? There's a discrepancy between the tax that you actually paid and then the amount that you recognized in your GAAP, right? Maybe they must have paid some amount still because there was some tax deferred tax liabilities in the previous year. That may be the reason why. I don't know. Let's take out Samsung Electronics, the remaining two companies' effective tax rates. How did it look like? Still fluctuating so much. Okay? Sometimes it's above 200%. It's crazy. Are you going to use effective tax rate for your valuation? And the answer is?
No.
Right? Capital expenditure and then working capital is the next thing to tackle. This is about the investment. CapEx, net CapEx especially, net CapEx is about your long-term investment going into the future. Working capital is about short-term investment. Okay? Both are designed to support your sales. So both have to be linked to your sales amount. Okay? Let's see. Capital expenditure should include any expenditures that are designed to generate benefits over many periods. Net CapEx is the difference between CapEx and depreciation. And then CapEx will be a function of how fast you're growing, and ultimately it is going to be linked to your sales. I'm going to show you a handful of pictures about this. CapEx as a percentage of sales. You will see how persistent that is. And then CapEx should include R&D, right? Research and development, right? Investment, we capitalized over the last couple of classes, right? And then number two, acquisitions of other firms. It's a CapEx if you're doing cash merger, especially. Okay? Some companies grow organically. They don't tend to acquire, but they just grow using their own money, using their own people, not acquiring anything right? Some companies grow by acquisition. Okay? One example that I show you is Cisco. Okay? Another thing that you can think about is Bank of America. Right? It started as a nation's bank or small bank before, and then they over time acquired another bank, and then eventually became the biggest bank. One of the biggest banks. Another one is Citibank. Right? Citibank, Sandy Whale, okay? Started as an investment banker, acquired this bank, and this is that insurance company, and another bank, and another insurance company like that, and it became a huge one. JP Morgan, okay? JP Morgan Chase is also growing by acquisition, has been growing at acquisition, right? Of course, JP Morgan has a history of like more than 100 years, but Jamie Dimon, right? He's originally from Bank One. Like Bank One was acquired by JP Morgan, but essentially it was the other way around. Key people, okay? He was actually the Bank One guy doing this project. And then before Bank One, it was, you know, they were merging like all different banks before. And Jamie Dimon is also from, subordinate, or used to be a subordinate of Sandy Whale. Sandy Whale, I told you about Citibank before. Growing with the acquisition. It's quite common in the United States. In Korea, acquisition is not that frequent. Okay? Not that frequent. Why is it so? Because the market itself is very small. The Korean economy is small. In contrast, we have two big players, two bigger guys, right? Chevers, right? Only a handful of them are just occupying this whole economy. So each different guys, they don't want to piss off each other. It's a kind of a gentlemanship kind of thing. So you do your business over there, I do it over here. Don't bother each other, okay? If you take over mine, you're going to piss me off. And then you're gonna... So they don't want this kind of struggle. What's the implication for you? Not much M&A business to do, okay? So many people say, many of you say, I want to become investment banker or M&A expert, but thinking about how many M&A deals are going on in Korea, not much opportunities in the first place. And there's a reason why, okay? Not much active. That's that. Let's get back to this discussion over here. Acquisition. We can interpret this acquisition as a capital expenditure. It's just like buying another factory, right? And then depending on the companies, right? Some companies, if they are growing with frequent mergers, right? Every year they're merging some companies, no problem, just take those acquisition amount as your capital expenditure as it is, okay? But most of the companies are merging infrequently, which means every 5 years they merge a big guy, right? Maybe every 10 years they do it. If it is infrequently happening, what do you do? Normalize the amount. Take the average, yearly average. If it is happening every 5 years, divide it by 5, okay? That's gonna be it. And then where do you find this amount that you spent for acquisition? Cash flow statement, okay? That's it. Here's an example of Cisco, okay? Cisco, San Francisco. Yeah. Logo is a golden leaf bridge, right? Telecom company. And it's a good example of growing with acquisition. How many deals did they do in 1999? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. It's big. Only including this big deals, right? How much did they spend? $2.5 billion dollars. So, when you're computing or estimating capital expenditure of Cisco in 1999 treat this $2.5 billion as capital expenditure, just like what we do over here. Okay? So what's going on in this table? Now, one more thing, okay, before I move on, is that this is a tech company, right? Telecommunications. So R&D amount is spent, right? So you treat this thing as your CapEx, $1.5 billion. Working capital investment is the next thing to worry about, right? Accounting terms. This is about your inventory to support your sales, right? Any decrease in this working capital means that you have more cash, right? Negative change in working capital adds to your cash, and positive change in working capital drains down your cash, right? So that's something to notice. And then only three items are important here: inventory, accounts receivables, and accounts payables. Right? It's all about the inventory that you have on your shelf. It's supporting your short-term sales next year. Now, changes in non-cash working capital from year to year tend to be volatile. Far better estimate of non-cash working capital needs looking forward can be estimated by looking at non-cash working capital as a proportion of revenue. Not the change of it, but the balance of this non-cash working capital. Okay? How much inventory do you set up over there to support your sales next period? That's the idea. Sometimes companies have negative non-cash working capital. The balance itself is negative. Too small inventory. Okay, that may be, well, just-in-time management, that's a good thing, right? Isn't it good? Yeah, that's good. But when you're valuing, okay, estimating the cash flow, okay, this may make you uncomfortable, assuming that this will continue into the future, will generate positive cash flows to the firm. Like this, while this is indeed feasible for a period of time, it is not forever. So it is better that non-cash working capital needs set to be zero, okay? When it is negative, okay? just to be more conservative, right? And then you can reduce the inventory once, but you cannot expect to have negative inventory forever, okay? That's the message. Now the charts over here shows the historical time series plot of non-cash working capital and net capex as a percentage of sales. Naver, okay, is here. Ever since their IPO up until last year, is shown. Red lines are percentage of net capex relative to sales. Blue line is percentage of working capital relative to sales. What do you see? At young stage, when you are young, you reinvest a lot. 70% or even like 95% you reinvest relative to sales. And then this reinvestment really quickly goes down, like that. Working capital stays quite stable, right? There's strong persistence going on. And then SK Telecom is shown over here. Naver looks like a very young company. We can make sense out of it. SK Telecom is rather, looks more like a granddaddy company. Very old one. Does this kind of regularity hold for this granddaddy company? Yes, it should be right. If you look back, long back in history, when this guy was established and then did the IPO, 1989. Reinvestment amount was about 70% of their sales and then quickly went down. Okay? What's the implication for your valuation exercise? Right? When you're valuing for IPO companies, right? IPO, you can pretty much assume the same pattern of reinvestment in the future. Right? Initial stage, you need a lot of reinvestment, but tapers off. Right? And then working capital level has been very stable. KPNG, right? What does it stand for? Korea, tobacco, and ginseng. I thought so. Does anybody have different idea? Korea, tomorrow, and finish it, please. G.
Korean tobacco.
I thought it was Korean tobacco. Just like what you guys said. It's not. Tomorrow and. Somebody help. You have to be very outside of box. Good life. Good life. Nah. I don't know why they named it that way. Korea tomorrow and tomorrow. Very distant name. But somebody have to be advised the management. Try to see you. Hey, you. I have to, you know, do something about your name, please. Brand. Okay, brand equity. So, most unexpected name I've ever encountered so far in my whole life. Okay? This is tobacco company. National monopoly. Right? Everybody buys your cigarette and somebody smokes all the time. Do you really need to reinvest anything? No. So that's why the reinvestment amount is this. Okay? Working capital, it has been high. 60% of your sales or 70% of your sales. Why is that so high? Why could it be? Does anybody have an idea?
The cycle, inventory cycle is very fast.
Inventory cycle is very fast. So you have to put a lot of things on the shelf in the first place anyway.
Yeah.
Is that right? Any other reason? Any other reason? Is this a very high thing or low thing? We don't know. How can we have a better idea about it? Maybe we should look at British Tobacco Company or Altria. That's another awesome, you know, name very distant from what it is. Altria. That is Philip Morris, Marlboro. Right? I don't know. That's something to investigate. So many people want tobacco and the cycle is very high. But why 60% of annual sales has to be on that shelf right now? Okay, why can't you make it quicker? Okay? The cycle quicker, right? That's an interesting thing. KEPCO, right? This is a Hanjeon electric utility company. Not much working capital changes, it's stable. CapEx, up and down. Maybe sometimes they needed to invest in more nuclear power reactor kind of things. Mostly stable. POSCO, very well established company. But one thing to notice is that their reinvestment is kind of lumpy. Okay, there's a time when they are diligently investing more. There's a time they don't invest as much. Most companies have shown this kind of lumpy pattern in investment. Samsung Electronics is not an exception. You see a lumpy pattern of investment going on. Right? Working capital level has been, you know, fluctuating a little bit. Hynix, lumpy investment again. Yeah, hugely lumpy. Hyundai Motors, and you see finally a zero working capital, close to zero working capital. If you are standing over here, okay, if you lived in 1990, and if you had to value the Hyundai Motors looking into the future, what did you have to assume for working capital balance? Should it have been zero all the way down to the future? And the answer is no. Take something positive amount. Okay? Don't expect your working capital to stay at zero forever. It's going to be a temporary thing. Kia Motors, 전기차, they're cousins of each other right now. And this guy happened to have negative working capital in the very early stage of their life. If you are standing at this point in 1983 and try to value Kia Motors, would you have to assume negative working capital going into the future? And the answer is no. Okay? Negative working capital happens sometimes, but don't expect it to occur again in the infinite horizon. It's a very transitory thing. You want to be more conservative about it. Why did I say conservative? If you think about this cash flow over here, decrease in working capital should have added to your cash flow. Don't expect it to happen, keep on happening again, or maintain it over here. Okay? So bump it up and assume it to be something positive. That's the message. The slide over here is more self-explanatory, so go ahead and read it. The last slide, okay, is again showing you with the numbers from the US companies. Amazon, Cisco, Motorola, all three companies, their working capital relative to revenues happen to be negative sometimes. Okay? But don't assume this kind of negative working capital happening again in the future. Assume some positive working capital as a percentage of revenue. That percentage may be industry average or something more positive. Okay, to be more conservative. That's it. Now, if you have questions about this? If not, we'll move on to slide number 9 and 10. Okay. Slide number 9, capital structure. I'm not going to cover that part. I told you about it before. So don't worry about it. Okay? Slide number 10. Okay. No need to. I don't think. Right. Slide number 10. I know this has been a long day, right? And a lot of class that you have to take. And you're bored to death, I guess, for most of the classes. So here, I posted 4 pictures, hoping that you will like any one of them. Okay? If you think, I don't like any of them, then it's hopeless. But yeah, entertainment business. Why did I post it over here? Because I'm trying to demonstrate a little bit about how I would approach valuation if I were you, right? Taking an entertainment company as an example, okay? Let's assume Andy came to be our entertainment stock analyst, okay? So that's what's going on. And then together with that, I'm going to briefly cover the DCF approach a little bit and then move on to relative valuation. Okay? Relative valuation, or in your valuation exercise, you need to compare. And you're not valuing just your own company. You have to compare with your peers, industry competitors. Okay? In the relative valuation, you will have to work with hundreds of different competitors, similar companies, or thousands of companies. You need to run a lot of regressions. So I'm trying to familiarize yourself with comparing with industry competitors. Now, relative valuation is IYG entertainment. I will walk you through discussion on relative valuation using Korea's entertainment stock, right, in 2015. I first start with DCF of YG entertainment to give you a flavor of how the firm has doing economically. You may question, why entertainment industry? Well, no reason, but fun, right? And then intangible, and it's difficult to conceptualize all their cost items, but we can still see those signals and then, you know, this picture that I did today. And then you may question, why YG? I love SM more. Sorry about it, but obvious reason for me, Psy belongs to YG. Okay? Globally legendary. The founder was the best dancing machine. Top expert in the industry, right? What does dancing machine have to do with valuation, you may say? But when you look at the CEO, okay, something you have to ask yourself is this CEO really the top guy in the industry, really the industry expert over there? That's have to be settled. Looking at Intel, right? Intel or Micron kind of companies. They're in the semiconductor or chip industries, and their CEOs have PhDs in electronic engineering. So they're well versed in that industry already. Okay? And they know what to do with it. Does that mean that you have to get a PhD? No. Okay? I'm not expecting you to become, you know, CEO of semiconductor industry in the company. But if you are in the engineering department, and then if you are thinking about working for engineering companies later on, you have to be the top expert over there. Number two, one thing I did not say over here is that if you are the analyst of a certain industry, you better be one of those, you know, you have to have some experience over there. If you want to analyze a certain company, you want to analyze some familiar company for the first time, okay? Some analysts, right? Semiconductor industry, get back to that one. Okay. Oftentimes, the investment banks hire the person from Samsung's R&D department as a Samsung analyst. Let's say I'm a Goldman Sachs guy, and I want to hire a stock analyst to analyze Samsung Electronics over there. I want somebody from Samsung's R&D department, who knows about the semiconductor, who knows about the product market, and then the mechanism in it, right? So you better start with whatever you are familiar with if you want to become an analyst. One thing to just, you know, fun facts, fun things I want to, you know, say, you may hate it, is that I like dancing. I used to like dancing. I used to love those. Try to be in your age when I was skinny. Once you become 45, you'll be like, just like me. Have no back. It doesn't move that way. But in your age, I was really into it. Okay. And then at one point, I was trying to go to, you know, Moon Nightclub or something. Moon Night. It was kind of a famous one where top dancers were getting together and they just compete over the dance battle. I wanted to see how things are going. As it turns out, Yang Hyun-seo at one point came to the TV and said something about Moon Knight. And there, Park Jin-young and those guys got together. Unfortunately, I was not, you know, able to see that guy because I got there too early. It was 7:30 p.m. They come at 11 p.m. and I came there at 7 p.m. and then the waiter was ripping me off. He was charging so much money, so I was like, 7:30, 8:30. I'm not going to stay here, I'm going. I don't know, unfortunate maybe. If I stayed there, what happened? I don't know. At that point, I was together with a couple of more friends who was even dancing better than me, and then one person was one of my friends who was videotaping how we dance. That guy who videotaped this is Kim Yoo-won PD. Wow. I never knew that my friend would become so famous. Like, oh, here, but he kept on doing, you know, what he's good at, what he likes. Follow your dream. Right? In my case, I wasn't able to. So anyway, so that's something I like, right? So, you know, I keep on, you know, watching this, and pay attention, and then see what's going on. Nowadays, I'm, you know, if you tell me to do something, I cannot. And if you say, are you the only one who you like this kind of rock and roll kind of things? And then I know. Tell you the secret. Kinder used to be. Used to be rock. Guitarist in the Kaist band. Okay? Moreover, skinhead. Like shaving it. That's what I heard. I may be wrong, but that's what I heard from my friends. So. Okay, he's a very talented one. Great. So, if you like something, start, you know, if you want to analyze some stuff, maybe you want to start with something you like first, okay? Of course, there will be some bias. Oh, this stuff I like it, so I'm going to die, and it's so high, and then you're going to be biased upward. Okay, let's take that, okay? So consider that bias, but still do it, okay? And over time, you will expand your horizon. Lastly, the CEO, okay? He's not Yang Hyun-sup, but his younger brother. He's very smart. Okay. So the chairman is an expert in that industry. CEO is extremely smart, very promising to notice. Now, does that mean that I have to buy the stock? Okay, but it's worthwhile investigating. Now, first look at how the company has been performing in terms of size, then ROE, and then we'll move on, okay? Move down the components of fundamentals, right? What do you mean by fundamentals? What do you have to look at, okay? So, big picture first. How fast did this company grow? And in the industry, how big is it relative to each other, okay? And then, if it is the biggest, it may be difficult to keep growing fast in the long run. If not, it may be easier to keep growing faster for a long period. Let's see. This is their revenue growth pattern until 2014. Okay. Sorry, I did not update it until 2016. I'll try to do it later on. But, so we are standing at the time point 2015. Okay, let's look at perspective. Number one guy in terms of size is
Sonyeoshide
SM, right? SM is big, SM. And then YG is number two guy in terms of size. And then JYP, unfortunately, the last one. Okay, fine. How did YG perform before, okay? When you're doing valuation, I strongly suggest you to look back in history first, right? I gave you all the data. Right? It's too big a data. You may complain, but you want to find out, I don't know. You want to learn about how to manage this big data somehow. Okay? Maybe you could ask your friend who is good at computer programming and then import those data somehow and analyze it yourself. Now, how did YG perform in terms of ROE is shown over here. Size is important, but that's only a part of the story. More important thing is about your ROE or ROC. How much return that you generate based on your investment in equity side. Out of these four competitors, they have been consistently top guys. You see it over here. Okay? That's why I like YG. Be the industry expert in the first place. Okay? Did he see anything? Okay, he was a good singer, but not that expert. Okay, great actor. Okay, great dancer, but not as good as this guy. So, ROE tells us this story. We signs, this guy's management style seem to come out in the show up in the ROE. And whenever you come up with, whenever you work with ROE, especially if you're doing some interviews, or job interviews, or real analysis, you may want to go deeper into your return on equity. Okay? What do you mean by going deeper into the ROE? You may want to decompose this ROE in your own way, in your different way. One famous way of decomposing return on equity is called DuPont analysis. DuPont. Kind of a French name. It's a chemical company produced the nylon for the first time. DuPont, right? And then, the company's name is famous in finance because of this kind of analysis that they did in their finance department. What was this DuPont analysis about? Well, it's about mathematical manipulation about the concept of ROE, the definition of ROE. Starting with the definition of ROE being net income divided by book value of equity, you do the mathematician's trick. Mathematician's trick is about what? Multiply and divide by the same number. And then expand it. Okay? So book value of equity, net income, they are here. Multiply and divide by the same number. Multiply and divide by the same number. Okay, we just do it two times over here. Which one to multiply and divide? Okay? It's up to you. But DuPont guys chose sales and assets. And it turned out to be very informative. So the first component over here is like net margin. Out of sales, what percentage becomes your net income? Okay, profitability is measured over here. Second item is about turnover ratio. Turnover, what do you mean? Based on your single dollar of assets, how much sales do you generate? Okay, you want it to be high. You want this guy to be high as well, right? And that makes your ROE. And this DuPont analysis tells you about, well, ROE being high, where does this come from? How do you make your ROE higher? Is it coming from better profitability? Is it coming from better usage of your asset? Or is it coming from the third item, which is inverse of leverage? Okay, inverse of leverage, what do you mean? This is book value of assets, this is book value of equity. But asset over equity sounds more like liability and equity over equity. It's kind of inverse of leverage ratio. So in the end, it looks like this. Net margin times asset turnover times 1 plus debt to equity ratio. Did I say inverse of leverage ratio? No, sorry about it. 1 plus debt to equity ratio. Now, why am I emphasizing this? Okay, what's the concern about ROE? People want to have higher ROE, okay? But there's a quality, kind of quality, okay? High ROE are not the same. High ROEs are not the same. Some managers achieve higher ROEs by leveraging more. Higher leverage gives you more financial risk. More chance of going bankrupt, okay? Makes you more risky. You don't want to do that, okay? Instead, you want some more better margin or better asset turnover. Yes. DuPont analysis enables you to figure out where does this ROE is coming from. So let's apply that kind of concept to our ROE comparison of these for entertainment companies. So first thing, net margin. Okay, net margin. Where does this YG stand? Always top. So they have been very profitable compared to the other guys, right? You can see that. And JYP, our unfortunate. Poor. What are you doing over there? Wonderverse kind of, you know, going to America and then trying to. I like that passion, I like that component, but unfortunately, it was not that profitable. Asset turnover. single dollar of assets, how much sales do you generate? Consistently, one of the top guys, right? YG. Key is, Daehyungjun company is kind of interesting to fluctuate over there. one thing to notice is that SM, okay, is not the top one in terms of profitability or its ROE kind of things. How about leverage ratio? Okay? Is the high ROE coming from high leverage ratio? And the answer seems to be no. Okay? Which means that's good. Okay? Less risky, yet achieving high ROE. Okay. Now, why this fundamental seems to be very strong based on this analysis? Now, the second thing to think about is, does this mean, okay, a strong fundamental, does this mean that you must buy the stock right now? Okay. And the answer is no. It really depends on the value versus the current market price. Okay. Price is observable, the value is not observable. Okay. Sometimes the price may go beyond the value, which means bubble. You don't want to buy that, okay? Even if the stock is very strong and fundamental. YG has been the second largest entertainment company. We know that the company has been maintaining best ROE over the last 5 years. Its average ROE, 20%, and we believe that the management would be able to sustain this ROE in the long run. Here, as an analyst, you need to have some kind of a judgment over there, okay? And you need some information. As long as Yang-Hyun is okay that these guys will be there, this will sustain. If you have any information that this Yang-Hyun will go away pretty soon, you cannot make this assumption, right? You need to have some different ROEs, okay? New CEO's activity, you have to think about it. New CEO's and then capital investment, right? Reinvestment for this company has been 77% of net income over the last 3 years. We believe that the company's reinvestment would be 80% of net income over the next 5 years because they need to invest more in cosmetic business. I should have linked it to sales, I'm sorry about it, but somehow I just linked it to net income this time. Let's not forget that this is FCFE, okay? One of the reasons I wanted to link it to net income is to make it easy to do FCFE. You remember, we started with net income, okay, in FCFE, and then thought about how much to reinvest. Okay, so this percentage figure over here linked to net income makes my life very easier. Didn't you say this reinvestment has to be linked to sales? Okay, we can still do that and work it out if you assume your net margin will be stable. Okay. So net margin and then the reinvestment rate, they connected later. Now, if we have some assumption about equity reinvestment rate, which needs debt to investing capital ratio, okay, then we can do the FCFE. In 2014, the company started to borrow money, and its debt to investing capital ratio is 20%. And we believe that the company will have stable debt to capital ratio. This part also, you have to talk to the management first. You're gonna meet some people from the investor relations department, okay? In your project, for your project, okay? The company's insider will come. And then that is the time you have to address this kind of question. Do you have any immediate plan to borrow more and keep your leverage ratio as it is, or lower, upper, or lower? Okay. And plan. You need to get some updates of information. And then equity reinvestment rate, 80% times 1 minus 20%. This is debt to capital ratio. Our alpha. Okay. 1 minus alpha. I'm seeing the 80%. That's 64%. Over the next 5 years, the company's net income would grow. Let's say it will be at 12.8%, because 64% times 20% ROE, we multiply it, that's going to give me the net income growth rate of 12.8%. Now currently, year number zero, net income is 18 billion won. And at the end of year number five, the growth will be stabilized. We believe that the company's net income will grow at 4% forever. And then we believe that management will keep on having ROE of 20%. So in the stable stage, we should figure out the equity reinvestment rate based on this ROE assumption and the net income growth rate assumption. So reinvestment rate, okay, equity reinvestment rate would be 20% in final stage, right? That's because 4% of growth rate you assume, and then 20% of ROE that I assume, right? Now it's time to have cost of equity, right? Once you can generate the future cash flow, right? And then the cost of equity we have to figure out. Risk-free rate 1%, and then market risk premium 5%, beta 1.25. We call this one has to be bottom-up beta. So the cost of equity, our good old friend, CAPM, pops up. Okay. So 7.25%. We use this information and then value it. It looks like this. Your high growth stage and stable growth stage growth rate differs, and the equity reinvestment rate differs, and then your ROE stays the same, 20%. That's our assumption. And then net income, we grow with this growth rate, and then stable stage is 4%. Year number 6, you have to go, and then free cash flow to equity is computed using our FCFE formula. Equity reinvestment rate 64% is out, the remaining part. Terminal value you have to calculate at the end of year number 5 based on this figure. And then what do you do? Get the present value of it, okay? Get the present value. I just label it as FCFE dash. And then market value of equity, aggregate everything, and then divide this guy by the number of shares outstanding, 16%. The value per share will be 39.028. I thought that would be a fair value, okay, of YG Entertainment. Now it's time to compare with the current price, 48,500. Of course, you could do some more sensitivity analysis by playing with all the other inputs and have a range of values, but this is how we do it basically. Okay? So at that point, my recommendation was sell over here, okay, at 35,000, like this over here, when the stock price was about 40 plus. Now after that, the price later on converts to the target price, but it took some more time, even went up before. So that's how we basically do it. We'll come back, and then Tuesday we're going to talk about the rest of this, and then move on to relative valuation quickly. Okay? So see you on Tuesday.